The real-life Buffalo Bill, his name was Gary Hodnick. He was born on November 22, 1943, to Michael and Ellen Hodnick, and was raised in the East Lake suburb of Cleveland, Ohio. He had a younger brother, Terry. His parents divorced in 1946. The Hodnick children were then raised by their mother for 4 years. Because of her alcoholism habits, she could not continue raising her kids. Before being placed in the care of their father and his new wife, Hodnick would later claim that he was often emotionally abused by his father. He suffered a lifelong problem of bedwetting, and claimed his father would humiliate his son by forcing him to hang his stained sheets from his bedroom window, in full view of their neighbors. His father denied all the allegations of child abuse, whether the father was telling the truth or not. One thing is for certain, Gary Hodnick is one of America's most notorious serial killer. Not because of the amount of his victims, but because of the way he tortured his victims before finally killing them. Gary Hodnick was responsible for one of the most grotesque series of crimes ever to occur in Philadelphia. His schooling day were not as happy as other kids. At school, Hodnick did not interact with his fellow students and refused to make eye contact. He had a weird-shaped head. Hodnick was also teased about his oddly shaped head. Young Hodnick fell out of a tree, which caused his head to be deformed. Even though he was bullied in school by other kids, nonetheless, Hodnick performed well academically and tested with an IQ of 148. With the encouragement of his father, 14-year-old Hodnick enrolled at the since-defunct Staunton Military Academy in Staunton, Virginia, for 2 years, leaving before graduation. After another period in public high school, he dropped out and joined the U.S. Army when he was 17. His time in the Army was pretty short. Hodnick served in the Army for 13 months. During basic training, Hodnick's drill sergeant graded him as excellent. Following basic training, he applied for several specialist positions, including the military police, but was rejected. He was sent to San Antonio, Texas to be trained as a medic, and did well through medical training. However, Hodnick did not stay in San Antonio very long, and was transferred to the 46th Army Surgical Hospital in Landstuhl, West Germany. Within weeks of his new posting in Germany, he earned his GED. In August 1962, Hodnick began complaining of severe headaches, dizziness, blurred vision, and nausea. A hospital neurologist diagnosed Hodnick with gastroenteritis, and noted that Hodnick also displayed symptoms of mental illness, for which he was prescribed trifloperazine. In October 1962, Hodnick was transferred to a military hospital in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where he was diagnosed with schizoid personality disorder, and consequently honorably discharged from military service. Shortly after his discharge, Hodnick became a licensed practical nurse and enrolled at the University of Pennsylvania, only to drop out after one semester. He worked at a Veterans Administration hospital in Coatesville, but was fired for poor attendance and rude behavior towards patients. From August 1962 until his arrest in March 1987, Hodnick spent time in and out of psychiatric hospitals, and had attempted suicide at least 13 times. In 1970, his mother, Ellen, who had been diagnosed with bone cancer and was suffering the effects of alcoholism, committed suicide by drinking mercuric chloride. His brother, Terry, also spent time in mental institutions and attempted suicide multiple times. Gary realized he could not work for other people anymore and was financially constrained. In October 1971, Heidnik incorporated a church called the United Church of the Ministers of God, initially with only 5 followers. In 1975, Heidnik opened an account under the church's name with Merrill Lynch. The initial deposit was $1,500. Heidnik eventually amassed over $500,000. By 1986, the United Church of the Ministers of God was thriving and wealthy, allowing Gary to buy a new house and luxury cars. The time came when he needed a companion. Heidnik used a matrimonial service to meet his future wife, with whom he corresponded by mail for 2 years before proposing to her. Betty Disto arrived from the Philippines in September 1985 and married Heidnik in Maryland on October 3, 1985. The marriage rapidly deteriorated after she found him in bed with 3 other women. Throughout the course of their brief marriage, Heidnik forced his wife to watch while he had sex with other women. Disto also accused him of repeatedly raping and assaulting her. With the help of the Filipino community in Philadelphia, she was able to leave Heidnik in January 1986. The pregnancy was unknown to Heidnik until his ex-wife requested child support payments in 1987. He had impregnated Betty during their short marriage. His habit of being with numerous women at the same time gave him a lot of kids with different women. Heidnik also had a child with Galen Cow, a son named Gary Jr. The child was placed in foster care soon after his birth. Heidnik had a third child with another woman, Anjanette Davidson, who was illiterate and mentally disabled. Their daughter, Maxine Davidson, was born on March 16, 1978, and immediately placed in foster care. Shortly after Maxine's birth, Heidnik was arrested for the kidnapping and rape of Anjanette's sister, Alberta, who had been living in an institution for the mentally disabled in Penn Township. His first brush with the law was in 1976. Heidnik was charged with aggravated assault and carrying an unlicensed pistol after shooting the tenant of a house he offered for rent, grazing the man's face. In 1978, Heidnik signed out Alberta, the sister of his then-girlfriend Anjanette Davidson, from a mental institution on day leave, and proceeded to imprison her in a locked storage room in his basement. After she was found and returned to the hospital, examination revealed that she had been raped and sodomized, and that she had contracted gonorrhea. Heidnik was arrested and charged with kidnapping, rape, unlawful restraint, false imprisonment, involuntary deviant sexual intercourse, and interfering with the custody of a committed person. The original sentence was overturned on appeal, and Heidnik spent 3 years of his incarceration in mental institutions prior to being released in April 1983, under the supervision of a state-sanctioned mental health program. Gary Heidnik started his killing spree. He kidnapped 6 African-American women, torturing and raping them. 2 were killed at the hands of Heidnik before he was finally captured. His victims were Josefina Rivera, was 25, kidnapped on November 25, 1986. Sandra Lindsay, was age 24, kidnapped on December 3, 1986 and murdered on February 7, 1987. Lisa Thomas was 19, kidnapped on December 23, 1986. Deborah Dudley was 23, kidnapped on January 2, 1987, and murdered on March 19, 1987. Jacqueline Askins was 18, kidnapped on January 18, 1987. Agnes Adams was 24, kidnapped on March 23, 1987. Luckily for her, she was rescued the same day. On November 25, 1986, Heidnik abducted a woman named Josefina Rivera. By January 1987, he had kidnapped another four women, whom he held captive in a pit in the basement of his house at 3520 North Marshall Street in North Philadelphia. The captives, who were all black women, were raped, bitten, and tortured. One of the women, Sandra Lindsay, died of a combination of starvation, torture, and an untreated fever. Heidnik dismembered her body, but had problems dealing with the arms and legs, so he put them in a freezer and labeled them dog food. He cooked her ribs in an oven and boiled her head in a pot on the stove. His neighbors called the police to report of a smelly odor coming from his house. Police officers came to his house after his neighbors complained that a bad odor was emanating from his residence. But they left the premises after Heidnik explained he is cooking a roast. He fell asleep and it burned. He ground up the flesh of Lindsay, mixed it with dog food, and fed it to his other victims. He was feeding his victims with human flesh from his previous victims. Gurry had different method of torturing his victims. One of his favorite method of torture was electrocution. Heidnik wrapped duct tape around the mouths of the victims and stabbed them in their ears with a screwdriver. Heidnik used electric shock as a form of torture. At one point, he forced three of his captives, bound in chains, into a pit. Heidnik ordered Rivera and another woman to fill the hole with water, and then forced Rivera to help him apply electric current from a stripped extension cord to the women's chains. Deborah Dudley was electrocuted to death, and Heidnik disposed of her body in the Pine Barrens in New Jersey. On January 18, 1987, Heidnik abducted Jacqueline Askins. The youngest of the six victims, Askins was only 18 years old at the time of her abduction. On March 23, 1987, Heidnik and Rivera abducted Agnes Adams. The next day, Rivera convinced Heidnik to let her go, temporarily, so she could visit her family. He drove her to a gas station and said that he would wait for her there. She walked a block away and called 911. The responding officers, noting chafing from chains on her leg, went to the gas station and arrested Heidnik. His purported best friend, Cyril Brown, was also arrested. Brown was released on $50,000 bail and an agreement that he would testify against Heidnik. In part, Brown admitted that he had witnessed Lindsay's death in the basement, and he also admitted that he had witnessed Heidnik's dismemberment of her body. Shortly after his arrest in April 1987, Heidnik attempted to hang himself in his jail cell. During trial, he claimed that the women were already in the house when he moved in. At trial, Heidnik was defended by Charles Peruto, Jr., who attempted to prove that Heidnik was legally insane. Heidnik's insanity was successfully rebutted by the prosecution led by Charles Gallagher. The fact that he successfully amassed approximately $550,000 through his brokerage account was used to prove that he was an astute investor, and therefore not insane. An astute investor who knew exactly what he was doing. Convicted of two counts of first-degree murder on July 1, 1988, Heidnik was sentenced to death and incarcerated at the State Correctional Institution at Pittsburgh. In January 1989, he attempted suicide with an overdose of prescribed Thorazine. Heidnik was executed by lethal injection on July 6, 1999, at the State Correctional Institution Rockview in Center County, Pennsylvania, and his body was cremated. As of 2021, he was the last person to have been executed by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. He remains the third of only three people to be executed in Pennsylvania since the resumption of the death penalty. The others were Keith Sittlemoyer in May 1995 and Leon Moser in August 1995. Thank you for watching Death Row.